Okay, viewers, I'm pretty sure at this point it's already been established that I have no life. Actually, I think Michael Jackson has more of a life than me right now. So it's only fair that I dedicate a part of this show to other teenage boys who also have no life. Now, before watching this, I want you guys to all make sure that your parents and or potentially imaginary girlfriend are out of the house or at least a good distance away from the room you're watching this in. All clear? Okay. So for this portion of the show, I, ShadowACS, I'm going to be reviewing Hentai. You're free to click on another video if you don't like that. The thing is, I might have no life whatsoever, but at least I have the balls, no pun intended, to admit that I actually watched this stuff, and I'd be lying if I said I watched it for the storylines. And I know more than anyone that for every good title out there, there is a mentally scarring one. And it's pretty damn hard to tell which one's which. So, since no one else seems to have the balls to do this, I am going to review the ones that everyone should stay away from. The ones that will make you feel dirty for days afterward. Because I don't want other people to make the mistake of watching them. And in case you're wondering, these videos are going to be 100% YouTube compliant. If I do show any of the sex scenes in them, they're going to be fully and completely censored. So, without further ado, let me take a look at a title that made me want to hang myself. A worthless piece of garbage simply known as I Can. Now, I picked this one as my first review because I think it's the one people are most likely to hit by accident. It lures you in with the promise of excellent artwork. But unfortunately, it is guilty of first-class false advertising. Oh, and I'm not talking about plot points. Here's the description that is found on most streaming websites. Ryota is an ordinary student. One day, when he is on his way back home, he accidentally collides with a girl, Miyu, and kisses her. At that moment, she suddenly transforms into an idol girl. Also, a mysterious creature called Kyupu appears. According to Kyupu, she is a limb of the devil, and she came to this world to make Miyu's wish, to be an idol, come true. But Miyu transformed herself when Ryota kissed her, though Kyupu didn't cast a magic spell. As a matter of fact, Ryota is the one who can amplify Kyupu's magic power. Well, get this. Not only does that stuff never happen in the show, they don't even refer to it! I'm surprised these people have not been sued! Actually, scratch that. These people know that they can get away with this, because they know that no one's going to go before a court and admit that they watch hentai. Our story begins with some weak camera pans over our main heroine, Miyu, looking pretty before an audience in a studio. And by the way, don't get used to her looking all pretty like this, because after this series is over, you're going to want to kill her! We then get some really boring and pointless banter between her and her boyfriend Ryota, but it seems someone sinister is watching them. We then see that she and Ryota are in fact living under the same roof, and that Miyu is actually a brunette. I would be paying attention to the dialogue here, but all I'm really thinking about is how many buckets of pink hair dye Miyu is going to need whenever she starts a show. At this point, Miyu and Ryota seem like a very close and lovable couple, especially when, in a scene that I'm not going to show you obviously, they start having oral sex. And by the way, this is where the first real disappointment of this show comes in. Because after they finish with this, they just stop and don't go any further. Clearly these animators have no idea how hentai is supposed to work. We then find out that the creepy guy from before is named Dirada, and that she's Miyu's producer. Now at this point, a seasoned viewer can already tell where this is going. A character who was intentionally shown to us as creepy is with a girl 20 years younger than him, probably, and he has full access to all her personal information and can get her alone anytime he wants. After some pointlessness and admittedly a pretty attractive shower scene, we see that Miyu is troubled but doesn't seem to be telling Ryota about it. Also, because hentai isn't really known for its suspenseful build-up, it's about 30 seconds after that where we see the producer forcing Miyu to make out with him. We also get the luxury of seeing him secretly groping her while she's trying to talk to Ryota in the middle of a public hallway. And this is where we get the first huge major problem with this series. I'm not sure that girls know this, but guys cannot get a hard-on when they're extremely angry. During any of the scenes between the producer and Miu, the audience isn't thinking about how attractive Miu is. All they're thinking about is how many ways they can murder the producer. Back at the house, Ryota and Miu start to make out, but are interrupted when one of Miu's idol friends, Lena, comes to visit. This was clearly a cheap cop-out on the animator's part, because Lena doesn't even do anything when she's there. She just says that she's worried about Miu and then leaves. In fact, you know what I think the deal is? I think the animators got into a big argument over what Ryota's penis should look like. So they decided to compromise in the end by hardly showing him with Miu at all. But don't worry, Miu's gonna have plenty of scenes with that lovable producer to make up for this. And speaking of our producer friend, back at the studio, he tricks Ryota into going to the security room where he can lock him in and have a clear shot at getting to Miu. Now I have to say, if they're trying to pass off the producer as an evil genius, they're doing a really horrible job of it. Hey dumbass, here's a thought for you. How many rooms are there in this building? And out of all of them, you chose to lock him in the one room with the security panels in it, giving Ryota a clear view of you raping his girlfriend. But it's okay, because Ryota is apparently even more of a dumbass. Even after he manages to break out of the security room and rush to his girl's side, he doesn't even confront her or the producer about what he saw. Now, if I were in his position, I would have grabbed the pipe the producer jarred the door with and beaten the living shit out of him with it. Instead, he just sits there like, oh, this guy just deflowered my girlfriend against her will. What an asshole. Heck, the dumbass doesn't even notify the cops about it. But worst of all is actually Miu herself. Again, I can't show it, but during the rape scene, she doesn't even try to fight back. And even after Ryota returns, and the producer is gone, she doesn't fling herself into his arms and start sobbing. No, she's totally indifferent about the whole thing and pretends it never happened. In other words, they're trying to imply that she actually enjoyed the whole incident. Now, I'm fully aware that women in hentai aren't meant to be realistic. They are, however, supposed to be likable. That's the whole point, to make you feel like you want to get together with them. Am I really supposed to be turned on by a chick who's willing to cheat on the love of her life just because an older guy rapes her? At this point, we've already reached the second episode of the series, and we're stuck in a downward spiral of what I like to call character degeneration. In layman's terms, this is the complete opposite of character development. In character development, the characters start off okay, but get more and more likable as the series goes on. If you remember, at the beginning of this series, Miu and Ryota were like the perfect model couple. Now, I just keep wishing for the writers to just go school days on their asses and rip their heads off. Now I know what you're thinking. Why does the plot matter here? It's only a hentai. Well, it is true that in most hentai I don't care about the plot. However, when the plot enrages me so much that I can't even get off from it, that's when I draw the line. Speaking of taking things too far, remember that Lena chick? Well, the very first scene in the second episode is her going to the producer and asking him to leave Miu alone. Finally, we have a good character who might be able to point this series in the right direction. At least, that's what I would say, except that this conversation takes place while the producer and his friend are raping her. Yes, because that's when all women would want to have an intellectual conversation about their friend's well-being. If anything, that's even worse than the scenes with Miu, because not only are we hating the producer for being such a douchebag, we're also gagging on the sheer stupidity of the dialogue. At this point, I am more than eager to get this over with, so let me just wrap up how the series ends. The last scene consists of Miu getting screwed by the producer in his office. While, of course, she keeps making remarks about how unmanly Ryota is, and how she'd rather keep getting screwed by the producer on a daily basis. And to add insult to injury, we also get to see Ryota watching them through a crack in the doorway, but of course, not having the balls to do anything about it. In conclusion, all I can say about I Can is that it's freaking terrible! During the rare instances where hentai comes up in casual conversation with my friends, one of the most frequent words we use to describe it is messed up. Contrary to popular belief, that phrase doesn't really apply to all hentai, but when it does, there's two different kinds of messed up. First off, there's the kind that's geared toward people with really extreme fetishes, and often have obscene content. Some good examples are Angel Blade and anything related to Lolicon. Series like this aren't actually bad, because as much as we like to deny it, there are people who have those extreme fetishes. Then there's garbage like this, which is messed up because it appeals to almost no one. It's pretty obvious that the creators completely missed the point of what they were trying to create. Hentai is supposed to turn you on, not make you want to go on a celluloid killing spree. The characters who are supposed to give you a hard-on are about as likable as Sosuke Aizen kicking a 5-year-old kid in the balls. Miyu's a cheating whore, Ryota's a pathetic wimp, Lina has no presence and doesn't leave any impact, and do we really need to discuss the producer? It's like the people who made this think their viewers are just a bunch of soulless bastards who are okay with all this stuff happening because they're just cartoon characters. And in reality, that's just a pathetic stereotype and it couldn't be any further from the truth. Yes, hentai can be a sick fetish sometimes, but just because someone has an unusual fetish doesn't make them a horrible person. And even if you are okay with this stuff that's happening, or just watch random sex scenes out of context, it still sucks because even the sex is terrible. Why? Because they always do it with their clothes on. In fact, there's about 10 seconds in this whole series of full-on nudity. Basically, this is like the Hindenburg disaster made into an animated porno. And frankly, much like the disaster, you want to get as far away from it as possible. Anyway, that's all for this, so we'll see you next time I do a top 10.